This is the Pro Audio Suite podcast. Quick Bites.
Welcome to another Pro Audio Suite Quick Bite. This week, we're actually going to discuss something that came up during our mic shootout, which of course included all of us, plus the, I think, a Grammy-nominated record producer, engineer, songwriter, musician, Jeff Silverman. We came to a few interesting conclusions, and I think one of them was that the NTG4 as a shotgun mic was a pretty good replacement for a 416 as far as taking one on the road, and you don't want to lose your 416. This ended up being a discussion on a Facebook thread that actually made me think, we do these shows, you guys offer all this amazing information for free, and then you get people kicking back saying, you know, oh, we disagree, and all this misinformation. So, based on that, and after throwing Robbo under the bus, it's time to prove the point. So, I've got both mics set up, and during the show I'm going to switch between the two, and one will be an NTG4 and one will be a 416. But, George, you've been recommending the NTG4, is that correct?
Yeah, I mean, based on the results of our shootout, which I thought was a pretty good shootout, you know, I was impressed with its ability to replicate a 416 pretty closely and do so much more closely, I think, than its brother, the NTG3, which was clearly, from a mechanical or from a, what do you call it, industrial design standpoint, was designed to be exactly the same size as a 416. And I just got off the phone with a client who has a 416, 416, and she has the Rhode tube, the shipping tube, which I think was designed for the NTG3. So I said, you know what? Go give the NTG4 a try. This might be the perfect stunt mic for you for traveling abroad and, you know, keeping your $1,000 Sennheiser back home safe. So she's going to give it a try. And I actually told her to try it with the low cut switch on. Being a female voice, I thought maybe it would work out a little bit better for her. So I'll find out, hopefully.
Although in our shootout, didn't the NTG4 sound a lot closer to the 416 when we turned that switch off?
It did for sure on Andrew's voice. It was too, the roll-off was a little too aggressive. But on a female voice that was not a deep, rich voice, more of a, you know, youthful voice, it, you know, you want to do anything you can to reduce rumble and garbage from your environment, and it could be helpful. But I said, you know what? I won't judge until you try it both ways. I'll send me a recording and with the settings in different positions, we'll find the one that works the best for you.
I'm trying to remember the shootout, and I do remember the other Rhode,
the NT1.
I remember that one being kind of remarkably close to the 416, and I remember being kind of stunned about that because there's such different physical designs.
Yeah, totally.
They really had even more similar. If I remember right, that one was even more similar than the NTG4 sonically. I know that, you know, from a rejection point of view and the way the hypercardioid pattern works out. But I do remember walking away from that going like, wow, that mic sounds like that mic.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, the interesting thing is what we did after the show was I sent you a copy of the NTG4 with the high boost on. That's what I sent to you, George, to have a listen to. And I think because we didn't do that in the mic shootout, but that was when we kind of went, you know, this actually doesn't sound that dissimilar to a 416.
I would not be surprised if in the lab they had a 416.
Make it like a 41. Yeah.
And they said, okay, our capsule is more flat, so to get a little bit more of that sheen of the 416, has sort of an 8K presence boost or something, then we'll just put this button here. And it does a pretty darn good job of simulating it.
Yeah. I look at, you know, you can hear it. There is a difference, but I don't think it's anything that's going to be that difficult for an engineer who's got, you know, half his chops down to match, I wouldn't have thought.
Well, and there's a lot of differences, like, the whole point is the huge difference in price.
And so
there's going to be physical differences and sonic differences, but I think the point was that for a microphone that has similar purpose, it can compete well with the 416, yet, you know, be far less costly, and therefore you can go travel with it with less stress.
And at the same time, it sounds more like the 416 with the high boost on than the NTG3 does, which does not have any boost setting. So sort of out of the box, you know, you're going to get a closer sound to the 416 with that NTG4 as a result. Or the NTG3 is a great sounding mic, but it does not sound like the 416. It's a warmer, more rich, lower end heavy sound, just totally different.
Andrew, if I may ask, in this thing, do you have that high boost switch on?
I
don't know if you're on that mic or not, but you will have that high boost switch on for the...
I do have the high boost switch on. That is correct.
I'm picking that you've switched mics a couple of times already.
You'd be correct if you were guessing that.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
Which one am I on now? That's the question.
Speak to me.
Okay. Which microphone am I on? Is it the NTG4 or the...
I'm going to say the Sennheiser.
Correct.
Yeah.
Well picked. What would you have said?
You chose wisely.
anybody think it was the Rhode?
Have you been on the Rhode during this test so far?
Yeah,
he switched back and forth
once. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
George sounded like the dejected schoolboy then. I was like, oh.
Yeah. Really? Did I miss that? God
I wasn't paying attention then, was I?
And you're the guy with the good ears. It's like, oh man.
Well, you have the Rhode NTG4 on low. The low cut is off, correct?
And the high boost
that's
is
off.
On.
Just the high boost is on. Yep.
Got it. Yeah. Yeah, it does a good job. I think even when it's flat, the 416 has just a touch more low end thickness, you know, whatever, just a little bit more.
It's that crunch in the top end too that we've always talked about too, I think, with the
the thing that makes it cut through everything.
Yeah, but
what is that that makes it cut through?
Well, you and I were talking about this before we started recording, Andrew. It was like, you know, whoever picks that will pick the $1,000 question, I think, because if another microphone company figures that out, especially Rode, by the sounds of what you're doing right now, if they figure out how to get that crunch up there, they'll be, I think you'd be lucky to pick it.
I think that crunch has to do with the tube, and also like one really important thing to realize is that the 416 is an RF microphone, and I don't think the Rode is, although maybe we can do a quick Google search to see, but it's a very unique process that Sennheiser uses for their entire MKH series. Are you guys familiar with it?
I've heard of an RF mic, but I don't fully understand what makes an RF mic different from a traditional condenser.
Let me see if I can explain it because it's a little bit geeky. An RF microphone has a carrier frequency, and the capsule capacitance varies the carrier frequency, or it modulates it, so that then another part of the microphone demodulates that, and that's your signal. It's a lot like an FM broadcast.
Wow.
And this is what makes the MKH series so great in weather and other things, because it's not prone to the same issues that a microphone that's sensing the direct waveform off the capsule instead of modulating a carrier frequency. And I'm sure someone's going to say I'm completely wrong, but that's the rough idea of how an RF microphone works. It's like an internal radio broadcast inside the mic.
Well, if someone says you're wrong, we'll do a podcast about that.
Yes, indeed. Yeah. Yes. Looks like two crosses are going up. But
that's a great explanation. I didn't know that.
Yeah, so with Rhode microphones, they're not RF, is that what you're saying?
I'm looking at their specs right now. I believe based on at least the specs that it's a traditional condenser style capsule mic.
And they're both condensers. It's just how it senses the waveform of the audio, essentially.
Mm-hmm. RF process must impart some kind of distortion, as you're saying, to the signal.
It might. I don't know really for sure where the distortion that is definitely there in the MKH 416, 416. It's one of those like good distortion things, but I think it has to do with possibly the RF and also with literally it's an interference tube.
Right.
And so the Rhode does have the interference tube. That's the acoustic construction of the microphone. I think there might be some stuff in there too.
But they can't
be the same.
They can't physically be the same, because Sennheiser has, you know, that stuff is patented.
Sue the pants off them.
Yeah. They cannot exactly duplicate it, you know. So they do their best to emulate it, you know, with their own engineering. But, you know, it's going to be similar very similar, not just exactly the same. So what's the point we're trying to prove? No, it is not
a good
exactly
mic that you can
the
use.
Freaking same as a 41.6, yeah, but right. It is pretty dang close for a third the price, you know.
Go ask Joe Schlepp in the street to pick one or the other, and I don't reckon anyone would.
I tell you one way of doing it is if you didn't A-B them, you just sent off a file from one of the mics. Mm. I doubt very much if any engineer would go, have you changed your mic or have you done anything or what is that?
Right.
I'd be surprised. I mean, there is a difference, obviously. And I think the main difference is, like Robbo said before the show, it's about gain, because I know the 416 or 416 is very loud in comparison and has more of that bottom end as well.
I mean, wouldn't the shootout be, you know, you have to do a commercial or whatever of a voice something, and you do it one day with one mic and you do it the next day with the other mic.
Yeah.
And the question is, how hard does that engineer have to work to make it seamless?
Yeah.
You know, does he have to just adjust the EQ a little bit? And my guess is that he probably doesn't have to work that hard to make a you know, the Rhode sound like a 416 in practical terms.
Another little thing that the NTG4 has and specs is power options. Like the 416, I know from experience, really wants 48 Phantom. Like it does not like to be starved on the voltage. And the NTG4s can run on 12, 24, or 48 volts. So sometimes these portable interfaces, the USB ones, they don't really put out 48. You know, they put out 24 or something. And so the NTG4 will be more forgiving. So that's another maybe little advantage that it has.
So the conclusion is?
Conclusion is you're right.
You can professionally use a Rhode.
And you can match it, Robbo?
Without a doubt. Without a doubt. Without even trying, I could tell you that you'd match it without too much fart-assing around.
Cool. Beautiful. Well, there you go. So crucifixion to the left.
Here, just bear with me for a second. We have here Rhode RF Biased Shotgun Black. What is this? Rhode NTG3.
Yeah, the 3, I believe.
It's RF Biased Technology. They do the RF thing.
Yeah.
Look at that.
Yeah, they try.
At least the NTG3.
That's their MK416, you know. That's what they built to be similar to, but it's tonally not. Like, it's balanced differently. And I think that's when they made the 4, they thought, well, now's our opportunity to try to get that sound, maybe. And it's rare to find a mic that has a high boost button. You know, that's pretty rare. You know, low cut, definitely more popular. So they really had something in mind, you know, when they added a high boost button. Because why would you normally ever need to do that on a mic? You know, you do it in post. Why would you need to boost the high end? So they were really trying to emulate the sound of something. What else would it be? I mean, I can't imagine any other iconic mic.
Well, the only thing I can think of is if you've got the mic in a cat and you're doing field work.
That's a
good
point.
You want the high boost for that.
Yeah, that's a good point. If it's in a really heavy windscreen, pole cat, dead cat, whatever you like to call those things, you know, it does attenuate the high end a bit, so that would compensate. That's a good point.
Yeah. Yes, I don't mean a real cat, Robbo. That's just weird and creepy.
I'm still trying to find out if the NTG4 is specifically an RF design or not.
I would be shocked if it was for that price.
That's true. Yeah.
Well, the only other lesson to be learned from this episode is if you come across Andrew Peters on Facebook, stay away.
Because he's going to bring out his boys. His boys are going to come out and come swinging.
Yeah. Whatever you do, don't cross him.
And on that note,
arrivederci.
That was the Pro Audio Suite. If you have any questions or ideas for a show, let us know via our Facebook, the Pro Audio Suite Podcast. Yeah. Trump.